Have you ever been conned? Deliberately lied to, maybe with the aim of getting you to invest in something? It's not a pleasant feeling, is it? Now, the nature of a con game is such that you're fortunate if you ever find out you've been conned. Years can pass and you still don't know. In fact, you may die and never know. I have in my possession a book written by a master con artist, his name, Bamfield Moore Carew. Carew shows up in a letter written by the second president of the United States of America, John Adams, who is writing to his one-time nemesis, Thomas Jefferson. This letter draws into its orbit people as far afield as Alexander Solzhenitsyn, visitors to the German town of Wittenberg, revelers in the town of Lewis in Great Britain, and, unfortunately, our General Conference President, Ted Wilson, which is what this DVD is all about. Stay tuned, and we'll connect the dots for you. Hi, David Mould here. I hate to take time away from our project to challenge Islam and Judaism with the gospel, but something's bothering me. In fact, it's been bothering me for years. Now, let me just tell you something. Back a year or so ago, I'd written about this particular problem, and I said, you know, Lord, this is your church. I'll write about it. Maybe you can raise up somebody who can tackle this full time. But a year has passed, and I haven't heard anybody come along that's seeing things quite the way I see it or see them. And about 2 weeks ago, I started being just bothered. And I'm saying, you know, the only way to get this itch out of my system is to prepare a sermon and tackle this subject, tackle this particular problem, which is what I did. About 2 weeks prior to our recording this, I started. And it's finally hatched in my mind. So if what the Lord is saying, I'm the one that's got to break this subject, then so let it be. Here we go. There's fraud being committed in the Seventh-day Adventist Church today, and as far as I know, it's not really being addressed with any intensity by those who see it. I'm referring to this counterfeit great controversy that's being pushed across the world field today by our leaders, and that includes, sad to say, our General Conference President, Ted Wilson. This last sentence I never thought I would ever utter, for I love Ted Wilson. 2 weeks before he was elected General Conference President in Atlanta, the Lord put it on my heart to visit him at his office in Silver Spring with some concerns I had about his safety and the safety of every minister scheduled to be in attendance at the Georgia Dome. When I was through, Elder Wilson told me I'd come to the right place, for he was in charge of the security of the building we were in then and would be in charge of the security at the Georgia Dome. How was I to have known that? All I did was follow the prompting on my heart to contact him. Needless to say, I was one of those in Atlanta who cheered when I heard he was elected, cheered as he requested the congregation not to clap but to say amen, cheered as he pledged to get the great controversy distributed across the world. But if I had known then that much of his subsequent efforts would have been to have this counterfeit distributed in the place of this book, I'd have walked out of that auditorium in disgust. So why am I getting so worked up over this? Because this book isn't just any ordinary book. The Great Controversy is a very special gift from God, and I believe it is slated to play a major role in the real loud cry, especially the conversion of Muslims and Jews, this book. I know the impact it has had on me. Year in, year out, I read it again and again. It continues to open my eyes. It prepares me for what is just ahead. To me, The Great Controversy is the second most important book in all the world, second only to the Bible. Friend, I wonder how God feels about this switching books. Let me give you a couple statements from Carl Porter Ministry, and I'll put it up on the screen for you. First, this one. The Great Controversy should be very widely circulated. It contains a story of the past, the present, and the future. In its outline of the closing scenes of this earth's history, it bears a powerful testimony in behalf of the truth. I am more anxious to see a wide circulation for this book than for any others I have written. For in The Great Controversy, the last message of warning to the world is given more distinctly than in any of my other books. That's on page 127. And by the way, Mrs. White never said anything like this about Steps to Christ or The Desire of Ages or any of her other books. She singled out this book as the most important she'd written. The next quote is from page 128. The book, The Great Controversy, I appreciate above silver or gold, and I greatly desire that it shall come before the people. While writing the manuscript of The Great Controversy, I was often conscious of the presence of the angels of God. And many times, the scenes about which I was writing were presented to me anew in visions of the night, so that they were fresh and vivid in my mind. Three times Satan tried to kill her as she wrote this book, and even after she wrote it, forces in the church were reluctant to publish it. In Manuscript Releases, Volume 1, page 169, she wrote, "Years ago, when I was in Battle Creek, I was much distressed that Great Controversy should lie idle on the shelf. For 2 years it was held back that Bible readings might have more attention. All that I could say did not change the course of those who had control of the canvassing work. They treated me as if I were a child." End quote. Then in Call Porter Ministry, page 129, she singled out patriarchs and prophets and The Great Controversy, and penned these lines, quote, "I know that the statement made that these books cannot be sold is untrue. I know, for the Lord has instructed me that this is said because human devising has blocked the way for their sale." This is back in Battle Creek. "Even in her day, there was human devising to block the way for the sale of this book." Do you understand that? Plans to block it. "It cannot be denied," she goes on to say, "that these works were not the product of any human mind. They are the voice of God speaking to his people, and they will have an influence upon minds that other books do not have." End quote. Can it be said that the great hope is the voice of God? Never. There is no comparison between the two. Nauseatingly bland, this cheap counterfeit is the voice of the devil himself, lulling the reader to sleep. Do you know what it means to be lulled to sleep? Let me tell you a story. Years ago, in the 1970s, I worked in a prison in Jamaica called the General Penitentiary. The superintendent of the prison at the time was Mr. Superintendent Jackson, Ken. And he shared many stories with me. One of them was about the rats in the General Penitentiary. This prison held over 1,000 men. And very often there was a lot of food thrown out at the end of the day. The rats in the prison were 1 foot long. Okay? And he said, "David, many a man has woken up in the morning with his toes gone. How do the rats do it?" There's been speculation throughout the prison. And the feeling was that they blew on the toes. They anesthetized the toes somehow, because the men can't feel the rat nibbling at their toes. But they would wake up with parts of their fingers gone. He told me that. Well, let me tell you, this great hope is putting God's church to sleep. And we're going to wake up with parts of our limbs gone. Mark my words. What have we said thus far? Before it was published, Satan launched his attacks against The Great Controversy by trying to kill Mrs. White. That's Adventist history. You can read that. Then after it was published, he tried to have it languish in our publishing houses unsold. That was then. So how does God feel about the church switching books today? Well, I'm not God, but I would imagine he's terribly upset. All I know is that I can't remain quiet anymore. To sit still and to let this travesty continue one day more without serious protest is unconscionable. How did Ellen White put it? "Any betrayal of the church is treason against him who has bought mankind with the blood of his only son." That's Acts of the Apostles, page 11. Strong language. Treason. And again, quote, to stand in defense of truth and righteousness when the majority forsake us, to fight the battles of the Lord when champions are few, this will be our test. Where are the champions for the Lord today who will stand up and call sin, sin? Tampering with the great controversy is sin. Butchering the great controversy as has been done here is sin. But the statement doesn't end there. She says, at this time, what time? The time when champions for the Lord are few. At this time, we, that's we who will fight God's battles, we who will open our mouths, we must gather warmth from the coldness of others, courage from their cowardice, and loyalty from their treason. That's volume 5 of the Testimonies, page 136. So am I accusing Ted Wilson of fraud? Yes, I am. His role in this treason is not in originating the Great Hope scam, for there are reasons, and I'll get to them in a minute, why I don't believe he did this. His guilt is in using his office to aid and abet the scam without protesting it loudly enough for us, the masses, the membership, the laity, to hear. You know what's really appalling about this? Elder Wilson knows better than I do every statement I've just quoted about the great controversy and every statement I've just quoted about treason. He probably knows Carl Porter ministry backward and forward. I know this because I remember years ago I'd gone to visit him at the Review and had a discussion with him about what Mrs. White wrote about the loud cry in Carl Porter ministry. And he knew it very well. Here's the quote we discussed that day from page 4. Quote, and in a large degree, through our publishing houses, is to be accomplished the work of that other angel, that's the angel of Revelation 18, who comes down from heaven with great power and who lightens the earth with his glory. End quote. Frankly, I wouldn't be surprised if it turns out that Revelation 18, the loud cry chapter in our Bible, the latter rain chapter in the Bible, is nothing more than a description of the results of the worldwide distribution of this book, The Great Controversy. And I've felt that way for years. Beloved, as part of his grooming for the post he now occupies, Elder Wilson held the position as president of the Review and Herald Publishing Association from 1996 to 2000. He knows these things. In fact, I believe it is because he's so steeped in the history of the publishing work that he made the call for the worldwide distribution of the great controversy to begin with. He knows the loud cry is going to be accomplished largely through literature, for God's prophet says so.